Hosting provided by Host Tornado. They offer website hosting packages, dedicated servers, and VPS solutions. HostT.net.
Programming Throwdown, episode 22, LaTeX. Take it away, Patrick.
All right, so thank you for that introduction, Jason.
Yes, yes.
You got the smooth radio voice going.
Yeah, I want to, you know, keep myself well-rounded. So I figured, you know.
So I'll do some, you do some. That way I don't steal the thunder.
Yeah, yeah. You guys missed the other three takes where Patrick did it. I just started screaming.
No, you were crying because it was so beautiful.
Oh, yeah, that too. Yeah.
All right, anyways. So I'm behind the times, but I finally decided to upgrade my computer to a new version of Ubuntu. So I actually went to the long-term support one or whatever because I figure I don't really like this. I hate this. So I'm just going to the LDS one. So I went to Precise Pangolin.
Yep. Precise
Pangolin. Bad idea.
Yeah.
So, do not like. So, I wish I could just uninstall.
So on my home computer, I've been on Precise Pangolin I was on Precise Pangolin. I'm on 12.10 now. And that, there's a whole slew of issues there. But when I switched to Unity, I didn't mind it too much, you know?
So I think this is the issue, right? So Unity, this is the new, like, I guess UI kind of name thing,
so
and widgets.
It's replacing GNOME.
Okay, yeah. All right.
So GNOME is what we had before, and now we have Unity.
I wish we didn't. Yeah. So the whole left bar thing, I don't like.
United?
No, I feel like they're just trying to be different just to do something different, right? Like, maybe, I'm sure, like, I don't get into the whole, like, I'm not really involved in the community very much. I don't really know the backstory, so I'm probably offending a million people here.
Yeah, everyone's so
That's okay. I don't like it, personally. My personal preference is I hate it. So, like, I want my thing at the bottom back or at the top where I can click on each instance of, like, if I have, you know, five Chrome windows open or five, you know, command windows open, like whatever it is. Like I want to be able to, like, switch between them on the taskbar. It doesn't work for me to not be able to, like, I feel like it's constantly in my way instead of helping me.
Yeah. So I, I've had it for a while. At first I hated it. Now I've started to like it. There's some things that still drive me crazy. And one of them is, you know, they have the dash, like they moved to this dashboard. So you actually have to click on, like, dash home and then type in, like, so if I want, you know, if I want Chrome, I click on dash home and then I have to type in Chrome and then it comes up. Whereas before, they had that bar at the top that had, like, applications, utilities, and it's, like, effectively like this multi-start menu thing going on.
But you can push Alt and get that too, right?
You can do what?
I think if you just tap Alt, it comes up.
Really?
I think on my computer it does. Maybe that's a setting. I don't know.
Maybe.
I feel like I did that on mine because every time I Alt-Tab and then I don't get the tab fast enough, that thing comes up.
Oh.
So maybe my setting is different. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, weird.
Maybe that's something too. Maybe I just, like, haven't tweaked in the settings right. Like, so I upgraded also a while ago to the new version of OS X. I don't even know what the names are.
Oh, yeah.
Really bad.
It was like Mountain Lion for a while. I don't know if it still is.
Yes, that's it.
Is that it? Mountain Lion.
And they switched the switch. So I was skipped two. Like, I skipped one. So I skipped the intermediate. Okay.
Maybe.
I'm really bad with the names. This is horrible. I should have researched this. It doesn't matter.
From Snow Leopard. Okay,
I went from scrolling normally on the trackpad to scrolling the reverse way.
Yeah.
I tried it. Like, I'm like, I'm gonna like this. This must be great. And then one day later, I turned it off.
Yeah, me too.
I'm like, nope.
Lasted a lot longer than I did. I only lasted about an hour. I was like, I can't take it. And so it's like, it's funny. I still think about it. So let me just give everyone sort of a mental model for what's happening here. So it used to be that if you put two fingers on the pad and you moved your fingers down, you scroll down. If you move them up, you scroll up. And it logically makes sense. But if you think about it in terms of, like, putting your hand physically on a piece of paper.
No, if the touchpad were the screen.
Right, exactly.
And it was a piece of paper, and you touched it and slid it up, the screen would move down. Like, the paper would, like, where you're viewing would move lower on the page.
Exactly. Like, if you focused your eye on a spot and then you took your fingers, you put them down on a piece of paper and you moved up, that spot, what you're looking at on the page would be lower. So you would actually be scrolling down by moving your fingers up.
It's basically like the tablet. That's what happens on a tablet. Yeah. You touch on the screen, and then the words underneath your finger stay underneath your finger.
Exactly, yeah.
Which is why it makes sense.
Yeah.
But on my trackpad, because I've been doing it for, I'm an old person, I don't know what it is. Yeah. Like, oh, people are like, they're now they're making fun of us because they're like, oh, those like, people aren't, they are not old. What are they talking about?
Were these crotchety old?
No, they're saying the opposite. They're like, those guys aren't old. Anyways, so like scroll, anyways, yeah, I don't like that. So that's my rant, but the Ubuntu thing I really didn't like. And I mean, there's all sorts of ways to get out from under it. The problem is like when you deviate from this, like you're stuck in this thing. So there's always been like when before I was a big Windows user, and I still do use Windows for a lot of stuff. You know, there's like all these shell hack things you can do to like make your computer look different. And that's cool. But then if you go to upgrade the next one, like it doesn't work and you're used to something different. Yep. So I feel like I want to stay as close to vanilla default installation as possible, because then I don't always have to like reinstall stuff and change stuff.
Yep. I used to do this. I used to even when I ran Windows, I used to have like all of these things. Like I had one which like split my desktop into four if I wanted it to. I had another one where like the terminal, like you could, it was easier to paste. Like, if you just right-clicked, it pasted instead of having to, like, do something else. I don't know. But, like, I made all these tweaks to it, and then I updated to, I think it went from XP to 7, and I lost everything, and I just said, forget it. I'm not going to waste time.
And then the
time,
same tools don't work anymore, and you can't do that. Or if you go use somebody else's computer, it doesn't work the same.
Yeah, yeah. I have a friend who's addicted. Well, he's, like, a zealot for Dvorak keyboards. And, like, he came over to my house and couldn't even, like, type an email. It was hilarious. Aww.
So, I mean, same thing. Like, I've always thought, like, oh, I should do this, right? Like, it makes the way the QWERTY keyboard is set up is retarded. Mm-hmm. Like, it's literally meant to make you type slower.
Yep.
And that's why they invented it. And we've probably all heard the story, right? So, like, I want to switch. But the problem is, like, I know if I switch, not every computer, like, I don't have complete control over every computer that I use, or I go use somebody else's computer, or somebody, you know, like, especially, like, at work, somebody, like, it's rare, but somebody sometimes needs to use, like, show me something on the computer or type something in. They can't use it.
Yep.
Like, you know, if I reboot or something updates, like, auto updates and, like, somehow removes it, and I boot up and, like, my password won't work, like, it's going to take me forever to figure it out. Like, then you're typing things that don't match your keyboard. Yeah, I don't know. It should be good, and I should do it, I guess. I just...
But it's for compatibility's sake, right?
Yeah.
It's just not worth it.
And that's the same thing with a lot of tech, not just software, but even other stuff. I remember like having early versions of iPads, right? Like essentially these other tablet devices or, you know, Palm Pilot style things. And they just never worked. They didn't have wide adoption. Yep. You were kind of out on the fringes, and they just didn't have the same support. Once something goes mainstream, we don't like it because now it's not elitist and cool at some level. But at another level, it's just so much nicer because now I can go to Target and or Walmart or wherever, Amazon, and I find like 100 different choices for what phone case I want if I have, you know, a current popular phone or an iPad or, you know, whatever, you know, like there's, because stuff is more mainstream.
Yeah, I mean, I have an Android phone and I still suffer from this a little bit, like, and not so much anymore because Android phones are getting more popular, but especially like a year ago, it's like I want this cool case, but it's only for iPhone.
Well, so I have an iPhone, this is what my main phone is, and like it works really. So I had an Android phone, and the nice thing is that they've gone less split. So it used to be like everybody had a slightly different version of the same Android phone.
Yeah, right.
You know,
right.
And it was very fragmented. Now they're going like less. So like one phone will be released across all the carriers.
Yep.
And so that's nicer because then you can make a case. But if you have like, oh, one has a keyboard and one doesn't, and one has a little antenna and one doesn't, like then, yeah, that never happens.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, it's a nightmare.
Anyways, yeah, don't like the Unity thing. I'm sorry, not a fan.
We'll see. I want to know your opinion in like 3 or 4 months.
So I've been at it for like 2 or 3 weeks now. So. Yeah. And I gave it a fair shake. I'm really tempted to turn it off, like figure out the best way to turn it off.
But you know what, especially with Linux or any of these OSs, you know what's going to happen. The next version, like whatever your hack you're doing to get around it now will be gone.
Yes.
Like it won't even be there. So. So
right, that's my rant.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
so now to something slightly happier. I'll take the first news story.
Yeah, now something slightly happier. A lot of people are killing each other virtually.
So Call of Duty Black Ops 2. So I'm not a huge like current gamer. I like video games, but I play a lot of old video games.
Same here.
Cheap. Sorry, I wait for them to like crash in price and then be like really cheap Steam sale.
You're not thinking, I'm thinking really old. Like
listen, now like I love playing my Super Nintendo games or my NES games or like man, like I like old stuff. I don't know, it's just simpler and I don't have a lot of time to play video games, or I don't make a lot of time to play video games, I should say. But it has 150 million hours have been played. That's crazy.
Absolutely insane. And $1 billion.
In 15 days, faster than Avatar hit $1 billion.
Amazing.
So like the new media consumption is so interesting. And it's so expensive. Like personally, I feel like
$60 or something.
I don't know how much. That's why I would say probably $70, right?
Wow.
Like, it can be really expensive, and I don't know. I mean, we should look at that. It's probably $50 or $60, but still, like, that's just crazy to me.
That's
like,
a ton.
That's a lot of, and I'm not saying like if you're gonna play it for a lot of hours, like, well worth.
Oh no,
it.
It's totally worth.
Like
it.
The dollar per hour thing.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I'm just like. Hitting $1 billion is crazy. Like,
yeah.
People have talked about this a lot, like, oh, are video games eating into the movie market or vice versa, and video games are becoming more like movies, and like, back and forth and all this stuff. And I feel like they're two very different styles of entertainment for me personally.
Yep.
I don't replace one with the other. I feel like they're just different. But, yeah, I mean, it's a serious business being in this now.
The thing that blows me away, so movies, right? So you could watch, you know, some people watch, let's say, Rocky Horror Picture Show, right? That's like a cult classic. Some people watch that show, like, every month. Like, they'll go and watch Rocky Horror, and it's like a big event, and people have fun, right? So it's not true that you only watch a movie once. That part isn't true. But if you look at, like, overall, most people only watch a movie once, like a particular movie. With a video game, the hours that you put into it vary wildly. Like, some people might play Call of Duty or any game for like a couple hours and they're done. And some people play it for like months and months and months, right? And so this whole like dynamic of sort of like just having this extremely variable mileage that you get out of this entertainment, I think it's just fascinating. And then you have this other thing too, where some games are like, you know, have this massive budget, like Call of Duty. I'm sure their budget was in the tens of millions,
right? Yeah.
Right? But then some games are just like Super Meat Boy. Have you played this game?
No.
It's a platformer where you have to like run and jump, and like there's little like things trying to grind. Like, you're
okay.
a blob
okay.
of meat,
okay.
and you're in this like meat processing facility, and
okay.
you have to go through all the blades without getting cut or whatever. And and it's like one guy made it, or two guys made it in their spare time, or I guess maybe it was their full-time job, but these two guys made it, and it provided me like hundreds of hours of entertainment, like trying to like navigate these mazes and all this stuff. And just the fact that like this ratio of like investment to return, and then return to entertainment, like these dynamics are just incredible. And it's something that like it's very hard to explore right now, or very hard to know, quantify.
Yeah, and the enjoyment, like, over time changes, right? So, like, if you go play, especially, like, this Black Ops 2, like, day one, people probably got online, started playing right away, and got good.
Yeah.
And then, like, you jump on, like, a couple weeks later, whatever, like, no, nah, let's see. And then you're like, no. Like, it's bad. And even with matchmaking and all that stuff, like, yeah, okay. I mean, you can alleviate some of that. But still, like, I mean, you don't always have the best. You have to stick with it before it becomes really enjoyable, right? Like,
mm-hmm.
before you're at least doing well enough where it's kind of fun. I mean, maybe it's fun before that too for some people. I guess,
well,
it depends.
You know, with the Xbox, they actually have modes. They have a hardcore gamer mode. Then they have another mode, which I can remember. But then the third one, which is what I picked, was family mode. And it doesn't mean you don't see blood or anything like that. It just means like
you can get through the whole game without dying.
Or yeah. It's like basically, well, it's for multiplayer. But it's like,
okay.
You have a family. You're not going to be able to beat this kid who like practices all day. So like you play in this league on your own with the rest of the people who can't play well.
yeah. It's like at the airport, they have this. They have like different lanes, like the business lane,
yeah.
the normal lane, the family lane. I always see people going in the wrong lane. It's like, what is the purpose of this? Is it like the family with like 30 bags, like going in the one that shows like business traveler, travels all the time,
yeah.
has one carry-on or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, like the, yeah, anyways, okay.
Yeah,
so the price is retail $60 for
the
console and the computer, but it looks like you can get it for cheaper.
So this
than
is
that
the thing
online.
That blows my mind, right? Is I bought, and this is gonna make me sound really pathetic, but I
yes.
bought Super Mario 3 right when it came out. Actually, to be fair, my mom bought Super Mario 3 for me right when it came out, and it was I think $70.
Wow!
And now it has been over 20 years. And video games are still selling for $70.
Like, oh, I never thought about it that
yeah,
way.
Yeah, like the price of a video game hasn't changed in 2 decades. And like just the amount of content and the budget has gone up dramatically. Like, I'm sure the budget for SMB3, Super Mario Bros. 3, was not what the budget of Call of Duty is, you know, even with inflation, right? So it's just, that part is wild. Like, the margins have come way down, right, on video games.
Yeah, I mean, but they're selling a lot more. Like, I mean,
yeah, that's true too.
Pretty sure 150 million hours weren't played in the first 2 weeks of Super Mario Brothers 3.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, I don't see the initial price. You're probably right. I mean, I remember seeing something about consoles being really expensive. Like, we complain about them being expensive now, but like that they used to be crazy expensive, especially if you take into account inflation. So yeah. All right, our next news story. You found something that you want for Christmas.
I also found on Answers.Yahoo. How much did Super Mario Bros. 3 cost when it first came out? This guy said $50. Oh, no, but somebody else said $70, yeah.
Okay, so around 50. Yeah, so about the same price.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry.
Okay. All right. Anyway.
Ruined that transition.
Yeah. So, yeah, so I totally, you know, actually my mom today was like, I don't know what to get you for Christmas. You know, she always says this every
year. Well, now you know she's going to spend $70. Adjusted for inflation.
Yeah, exactly. So I want a Super Mario 3 cartridge. So I actually think this thing is totally cool. I only found out about it minutes before recording the show, but I immediately want one.
Lots of research.
Yeah, after lots of research. They have an Android stick PC, and the idea is it has an HDMI port, so you can plug it into your television. This one
and it looks
I
like a thumb
to,
drive.
Yeah, that's right. It's very small. This one I linked to apparently needs like certain type of TV that can provide power through the HDMI cable.
Yeah, that one, I mean, it looks like it has a port there for like a USB power over thing. Yeah, so you can either, if your TV supports getting power from HDMI, that'll work, which the newer TVs do, but there's a way to power it alternatively as well.
Oh, perfect. Yeah, so you can, so imagine like you have like the kind of Android power that you would in a phone or something, but it can connect to your TV without having like a mini HDMI. Like it just has complete HDMI. And you can have it like hook up to your TV 24/7. And you do all sorts of cool stuff with it. So I think it's a really fun toy. I think that there's a lot of cool stuff I'd want to do with it.
Yeah, they it's kind of like the Raspberry Pi style thing, right?
Yeah, yeah. You can plug in or you can use a wireless keyboard and mouse. So I'm assuming it has some kind of Bluetooth receiver or transmitter. So yeah, it seems pretty fun. I just found out about it, so I haven't thought about what cool stuff. Immediately, the thought that comes to mind is to get MAME running on it and then have like
to play arcade games.
Yeah, yeah, have like the smallest arcade cabinet ever. Actually, I want to get into like woodworking, like not serious, like where it looks good, but just like a saw and a piece of wood and have like be able to make stuff because I'm like I'm really inept.
We'll have to talk about this another time. I actually started doing woodworking, but
did
like
you really?
The kind where it looks good.
Oh wow, we'll do that next show. That'll be our intro.
All right.
We'll have to remember. Okay. Anyway, so. I want to make...
Well, I should... The kind of look like attempting to try to make it look good, sorry.
The goal is good.
Okay,
mine,
yes,
the
yes.
goal is just mediocre, yeah.
Okay.
Just functional. See, so, yeah, I want to make an arcade cabinet with one of these little sticks and like, I don't know, like a really tiny... Or maybe like an arcade
I think somebody
that
did that. I saw that.
Pocket
on one of the like hacker, like
oh,
computer
really?
Hacker things. Yeah, like
oh, nice.
Super miniature arcade cabinet or something. It was like really small.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, yeah, who knows what I'm going
to
do.
Maybe it'll be
thing.
A kit, and then you don't have to do any woodworking. Your
oh,
woodworking,
perfect.
Your woodworking can just be to glue it up, and then you don't even have to worry about it. So this one looks like it houses your phone.
Oh, that's awesome.
But you could do, like, I mean, you could hack it to just be something else. Okay, anyways,
yeah,
we're
totally.
Looking at pictures, and you guys cannot see them.
Awesome.
So, best podcast ever.
Speaking of woodworking.
So, yeah, so on my notion of crazy things to do with woodworking, because one of my goals with woodworking is to build automata. So
really?
Automata are those, well, it means a variety of things, but the ones I'm thinking of are wooden contraptions where you have like a little hand crank on the side and you crank it and there's like a scene that takes place, like almost like a diorama, if you know what that is,
yep.
on top of the little box. So you like crank it and there's like, you know, like a horse that pretends like it's running or like a caterpillar pretends like it's
oh,
crawling.
That's amazing.
Or some guy that's like pretending like he's eating a sandwich and waving or a dog that jumps through a hoop. Right? Like,
I saw something that was totally epic. That's what, along the lines of what you're talking about. This guy made a bicycle and as part of pedaling the bicycle, a set of mechanical actuators and stuff went, and it's totally analog, so it's not computer or anything. A pen drew his signature. Or like something that was pretty close to his signature.
Yeah.
So
this would have like gears and pulleys and screws and yeah, all these crazy things to make the things on top do something. And then you leave the bottom where all those things are exposed so that people can kind of see it working. That's part of the nostalgia of it or whatever.
Yeah, right.
That's what I kind of want to do.
That's
so,
amazing.
But it's a very lofty goal. I don't know when I'll make... So the other thing I want to do is make a wooden clock. So you can make
really?
like all the gears and the pendulum and the escapement, the
everything
thing that makes
wooden?
It tick, and it's all out of wood.
Right. Wow.
So have crazy grandiose ideas.
Oh, that's amazing. So do you have a woodworking, like, I mean, do you have some kind of benches?
I'm acquiring it. Oh, so like, okay. I'm like in the process of like starting, like doing some small projects, learning the skills, that kind of stuff.
That's
working
awesome.
My way up.
That's great.
So I saw this and it immediately intrigued me, because when I was growing up, I would always be the kid in the class who, like, when somebody asked something, I'd be like, why? But like, not just to be like a jerk, but like really wanted to know, like, like, why is it that way? And so like, one of the things was computers, like, oh, it counts in binary. And it's like, for the longest time, I thought like, oh, binary couldn't represent every number. Because like, somebody just told it to me, like, that's crazy. Like, ones and zeros only, like, seriously?
Yeah.
And nobody bothered, like, nobody, my teachers at the time didn't know how to really explain that to me, that like, no, this is, it's a number system, here's why it can represent every number.
Yeah, it's base two.
None of that, right? It's like, completely more obscure. And one of the things, once I figured that, I was like on this quest, like, I want to understand how a computer processes things. Because people know this, right? Like, oh, people who know a little bit about computers would say, like, oh, it has an instruction set. You'd be like, what? Like, what's an instruction set? What does it do? How does it, like, how does it know the number, know the other number, put the numbers together, you know, and make something, right? Like, how does that work? And so this kit called the Digicomp 2 is something that was made in the 50s. And what it is I'm just going to try to describe it. It's like a wooden flat piece of wood that's on an angle.
Yeah.
And it has like a, looks like one of those labyrinth things where the marbles kind of like flow through or whatever. And there's little wooden toggle pieces. So it's all toggle. And it has the little ball bearings. I think they're actually pachinko balls.
nice.
So little ball bearings that flow through these wooden channels down this slanted board. And then there's little toggles you switch left and right that are like essentially the instruction set, the bits that you can kind of like put into positions. And as stuff flows through, you can do things like create an adder or create a, you know, maybe even a multiplier. It has like a whole instruction set that you can do. I didn't fully kind of read through everything because I was like, oh, I'm going to want one of these and it's going to be a terrible thing. So the old one made in the 50s was like this plastic thing, and it was kind of cheap. And people use this to learn like how did the binary work and how to like set the instructions and make it go. And these people created it out of wood to kind of like for a new generation of people. So it's fairly expensive. It's like a couple $100. But they said they were trying to like do this to be able to make another one out of like a sturdy plastic and kind of educate people. And it was like supremely fascinating to me that like doing general purpose computation in something that isn't a, you know, electrical manner.
Yeah, it's amazing.
So it's all completely in like the real world. There's no, it doesn't plug into the wall. There's no batteries.
Yeah, you guys should definitely, you know, we have links for every article. This is like a highly visual, you should definitely click on the link and check this out, because this is really impressive. I wonder if they have a YouTube video.
Oh, that'd be cool. So, I mean, I just kind of like have this like thing like teaching. So I have a, you know, daughter now, she's just a year old, but I have like this grandiose vision of like teaching her to program on this thing, right?
Yeah,
like,
yeah, totally.
Oh, I'm gonna like just, here, this is how you do your instruction set, and here's how you program in the numbers, and here we're gonna learn. Oh, I don't know. Maybe that's probably completely unrealistic. Probably completely just turn her off of like ever wanting to do this. So
if you go on YouTube and you type Digicomp 2, but with 2 you do 2 I's, you like the Roman numeral for 2, you'll actually see a video from the evil mad scientist team where they've assembled a gigantic version.
Oh, it looks like they're using pool balls.
Yeah, in this case, they're using 8
what?
Balls.
That's crazy.
And they have an absolutely gigantic. And I'm assuming, yeah, at some point they'll show you how.
Oh, so yeah, so you can set the instructions. And
so
then,
this is where they're setting the numbers that they're going to operate on.
Yep.
And
then they're going to turn it on, and then the balls will begin to flow through.
And then the one of the operands will turn into the answer.
Right, so
something.
Things will switch position. And then when it's done, you can read it, and the computation is performed.
That is amazing. So how do they know how many balls, like how many cycles?
So I think, they actually ask it. So it depends on exactly what instruction is being said, but they said typically 30. So when it finishes, I think essentially there's a ball that hits the off switch and stops the flow of balls at the right time. And then, you know, so it's like only kind of like one, as like each ball flows through, it kind of triggers the next ball. Right. So eventually when the operation is finished, that no longer happens. So, like, that's the final thing. That's how you know the statement is over.
Oh, this is amazing. Yeah, you guys have to watch this video.
It's not amazing to sit here and watch us talk about it.
I'll also link the video.
Or watch us talk about it. Wow. No. Listen to us talk about it.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyways.
Cool. So I don't know about you. I think you did. We talked about this on an earlier show. But I made a lot of games for the calculator. Did you do this?
Yeah, she told us about your cheating. I mean, creative. Yes, I did as
well.
Told
us about our
like a little RPG program. On my calculator.
Yeah, I also made an RPG. And one funny thing was I knew like just enough about regression models to sort of get by. So I had a quadratic regression that I did on the calculator to fit a function curve to like a set of points. So I kind of knew that like somebody at level 13 should have like this many HP and somebody at level 15 should have this many HP. So I kind of like did like some testing on my own at different levels to sort of figure out good values. And then I used like a regression curve to like...
Oh, wow. And then, I did not do that.
So as an artifact of using this regression curve, the levels and everything, even the monsters' levels could go up to infinity because it would just like follow the curve. And so I had people like classmates of mine saying, dude, once you get to level like 57, this game's impossible. And I'm like, I only designed for it to go to like 13. He's like, yeah, he's like, at first I was fighting like, and I used also the text, like chromantic meant like five times the level, you know? So he's like, I was fighting like chromantic, like insane, like hardcore black dragons. And all of a sudden I was fighting random characters. Because I couldn't generate the name for these guys. And he's like, and then the game got impossible. You need to fix it. I was like, how many hours did you spend? He's like, I don't know, like hundreds. But yeah. So we,
and then you filed a bug report against your code, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I'm like, I'm 13. So.
And then he threw you in the trash can.
Yeah. He just filed a bug report against my face. So somebody actually made a clone of or a game inspired by Portal on their calculator, on their graphing calculator. And so it looks pretty awesome. You can you actually have 8 directional control, so I'm assuming he's using like the keypad to shoot the laser and then maybe the left right.
Gun. What's it called?
Oh right, the portal gun. And then the left right to move around. But yeah, you should see this. It's pretty awesome. If you're a fan of like if you have a graphing calculator, you could probably get this on there somehow. So it's all written in TI Basic, and does he have a web version?
Oh no, I don't think so. So it runs on the TI-83 or the TI-84.
Okay. I believe the TI-83 and the TI shameless plug here and the TI-84 are emulated by MESS. So just some
project. That's what I want to do.
Which is a project I work on my spare time. So you can actually play this in MESS, I'm assuming. I haven't tried it, but if you could download it, you could probably play it on MESS. So if we do that, I'll let you know.
So for all those people with time to waste in their math classes.
Yeah, totally. This is way better.
We expect this from you.
This is way better than TI Mario, which is what I remember from my high school classes.
All right. So now it's time for Tool of the Show.
Tool of the Show.
Yeah, we dropped the bye week.
Yeah, we dropped the bye week. Sometimes, you know, I think this week, it's actually been less than 2 weeks.
No.
Has it not been? Man, time flies. Basically, what happens is we're operating on dog time, like dog years. So
I don't.
Like every week is really 8 weeks. So I don't know. I'm making that up.
That doesn't make sense. Yeah. I think that's opposite. We need something that runs slower.
Yeah, but I think like the outside world is going at 8 weeks, but we feel like it's a week because we're really busy.
Okay, so that would be something that lives a long time.
Oh yeah, so we're the dogs.
What?
I don't
know.
Stop. This is going downhill. So the tool of the show. My tool of the show is.
He said all that to say we're really busy and we're sorry we don't get these out more often.
Yeah, definitely. I want to try and keep it more regular. So we're going to try to keep it on a 2 week schedule, but you know it's pretty erratic right now. So, Cocos 2DX and Cocos 2D HTML5. These are my app tools of the show.
Like hot cocoa?
Very much so. They're both Cocos. Steaming, hot, and so. Okay, a little bit of history here. So it started off as Cocos 2D, which was a Python game library. For programming on the desktop. And then when the iPhone came out, they made a Cocos 2D iPhone, which was written in Objective-C for the iPhone, but it had a very similar API. And a lot of the functions, a lot of the things you could do were the same. That got really popular. It became like the number one game development environment for iPhone for a long time. They made a Cocos 2D Android. There's a whole bunch of Cocos 2D everything.
then somebody had this genius idea, and the genius idea is you can run JavaScript on iPhone because you can compile the JavaScript interpreter on the iPhone. Okay. And yeah, you can run JavaScript on iPhone. You can run JavaScript on Android, and you can run JavaScript on the browser, obviously. So we just make a system or a set of like a framework so that you write your code in JavaScript and it'll run on the browser, the Android, the iPhone, and like 10 other things all for free. And that's what Cocos 2DX is. And so it's pretty awesome. I mean, one of the cool things about it is you can write in Cocos 2D HTML5 and you can test and do all your testing and development on the desktop.
In the browser?
Yep, in the browser window. You can show it to your friends. You can be like, hey, go to mycoolwebpage.com and check out my game or whatever, so they can play it. You know, once you've sort of got like, you know, a prototype and something that you feel pretty, you know, confident about, then you can just go to the iPhone or Android backends, and most of it just works.
Nice.
Yeah. So you'll have to change the UI obviously because you're going from a mouse to a touchscreen, so you might have to change some stuff there. But the vast majority of the code stays the same, which is totally awesome. So highly recommended if you want to do any game programming on mobile.
Very cool.
Yeah.
I have another non-open source tool. Surprise!
Ding, 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 ding.
All right. So mine is Snapseed.
Yep.
So Snapseed used to be pay and is now free on both Android and iOS. And nice. It is a photo editing application for your devices, your mobile devices. And this is produced by a company, Nick Software, who I think recently was bought by Google.
Oh, okay.
But Nick Software, they do actually really high-end Photoshop plugins. And they're really expensive, and they're really well-recognized among professionals. But Snapseed is really intuitive, easy way for you to kind of like do... think like if you ever used Picasa, like think like Picasa, but like on your phone. Like, oh, auto-correct the colors, auto-correct the exposure, apply these filters,
wow.
Those kinds of things. And I was testing it on my Nexus 7 earlier. I also have it on my iPad. And wow, that sounds like really bad. I shouldn't say things like that. Like, oh, I have it on all of these 10 devices.
Well, everyone knows you're just total. It balances us out though, because I am not a technophile at all. Well, that's not a right word of saying it. I like tech, but I don't like gadgets. Like, I'm not a gadgetophile, if that's a word. So I just got the smartphone not too long ago, and like I'm a late adopter to like almost all tech. So, gadgets. So, we make a good compliment. We compliment each other. So, for everything I don't have, you have.
Oh, it's not actually showing. I was trying to show Jason, but it's not. It's
so,
not
wait, what are you trying to do?
So, this is like, I have a picture here open. This is going to be really boring to everybody. So, you can just apply things, and you drag left and right to
adjust. Oh, that's cool. Change the brightness.
Up and down to select what you're adjusting. So, here I'm adding more grain to make it look like film.
So he's showing me a picture of his daughter that is just turning into like a zombie with all these crazy effects. It's kind of weirding me out.
Sorry, yeah, don't offend. I'm offended. Maybe
it's
my daughter.
No, that looks really cool though. Can you do like, so one common thing that I want to do in pictures is blur out like my license plate, let's say. Like, so for example, I took a picture.
I want to ask why you want to blur stuff out in all your pictures. So anyways, I don't know. We can look into that. I don't know.
I took a picture of the back of my car to show I was carrying some really heavy things in my car. Now you're like sticking out the top of the car. And I wanted to blur the license plate of the car in the picture. And so will this do that kind of thing too?
Maybe. I don't know. Oh, I haven't looked at that. That's very specific. I don't know. This does like general correcting and color correction, that kind of stuff. So it works really well. It's really intuitive. It's one of those things where instead of just porting the phone version or the desktop version, and like they really tried to go a little bit farther with the interface and make it more intuitive about what you're supposed to do and how to do it. And yeah, check it out. I mean, it's free, right? Like what, you know, can't be that terrible if you can check it out for free. Well, I guess it could be terrible, but it doesn't a lot of risk to you. So, okay, now you're trying it. Now Jason will not
it's
be paying
very grungy.
For the rest of the show.
I chose grunge, and it definitely feels, I feel like that's pretty.
Industrial grungy picture.
It's a pretty grungy tree.
Yeah, all right. So he's trying it with the default picture. Okay. So check it out, Snapseed. All one word. You can check it. We have a link to Snapseed.com, which I assume has one to both the iOS App Store and the Play Store.
Yeah.
For all those devices you guys may or may not have.
Cool.
If you don't have them, I guess it's not helpful. But yes.
Yeah. It supports the ones you have and the ones you don't have. It's pretty cool.
And it's cool because sometimes you take a picture and it just didn't turn out quite right. And you want to just fix it a little bit before you send it out or post it on a social network or whatever.
So, yeah, that's great. That's amazing.
So we're starting something new this show.
Yeah,
something new.
Totally.
22 episodes in.
I know. We should have done this episode once. A great idea.
Wow. Jason's tooting his horn.
I'm already happy about this. So a lot of people, email us, post on our G+, and they say, you know, I want to get into programming. How do I do it? Or, you know, I want more resources on programming.
You guys don't yak enough.
Yeah, exactly. And so, you know, one thing is about the show, we can't say, like, oh, and then type C out this, and then, because that would be the most boring episode ever. No one would want to listen to that. I wouldn't want to listen to myself saying that. So, we sort of talk about things at a high level, but the reality is, for somebody to start coding, they also need some help. They need some resources, like some text that they can look at. And so we are starting the book of the show.
Book of the show.
Book of the show.
Where Jason and I recommend a book for you to read.
Check out this book.
It's going to be awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So
I think everybody's tuned out now. Just you and me. Yeah.
What is that guy called? The guy who busts through the wall and goes, oh,
the
yeah.
The Kool-Aid Man?
Oh, is it the Kool-Aid Man?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. We need the Kool-Aid Man guest speaker for Book of the Show.
I will insert that sound effect here.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. No, that was all just right. Still Jason.
No, that was me again. Okay. So Book of the Show. Keep in mind, we're going to provide links for you to buy these books, and we're going to set this up through the Amazon affiliate program. So running the podcast actually costs us a significant amount of money, and it also costs Host Tornado, who's our benevolent benefactors, or we're their benefactors of their bandwidth. There are a lot of B's in that statement.
So what Jason's trying to say here, I'll break it down into plain English. He's saying, yeah, so I mean, there are some expenses associated with the show. And, help offset that. We're going to try to recommend some stuff that we think is useful for you guys.
Yeah, totally.
And if you, if you do decide you want one of these books, if Amazon has a good price and, you know, delivers in a good manner to where you live and you'd be interested in buying it that way, that would help out the show, and we'd appreciate that.
Yeah, I mean, just to put things in perspective, we used, can you add these numbers in off the top of your head?
No.
Like 80 is about 200. This is about...
So you used like a terabyte.
Yeah, we used about a terabyte of bandwidth last month alone. So that's a lot of bandwidth. And so, so if you are going to buy these books, if you're interested, please, please help us out. Buy them through the Amazon link that we provide. That would be awesome. So,
but in general, we're going to recommend these books. If they haven't at your library and you want to get them that way, I mean, that's totally cool, right? Like,
yeah.
These are things that we think are, like, good resources
totally.
In general for you to consider looking at.
Yeah, we're not going to shill you either. Like, we're not going to just recommend anything. Like, if we don't have a book, we won't recommend it. And we're only going to recommend books that we've at least read most of. So
yes.
And we know are good. So anyways, without any further ado, my first book of the show is Algorithms in C++ by Robert Sedgwick. This book got me all through college. It's an amazing book. So it does algorithms in C++, but if you're like a Python or a Java coder, you shouldn't worry. You'll have to learn basic, C++ to know what's going on, but that shouldn't be too bad. And the nice thing about C++ is there's no hidden complexity. So, if he did algorithms in Java, and I think actually there is an algorithms in Java book, and they are pretty good about not doing this, but you could see the case where someone's like, there's a for loop, And so because of that, it takes n time because you have a for loop. But the reality is inside that for loop, you're calling some Java function like collections.sort, which takes, n log n, right? So some languages that have a lot of, as you say, batteries included can sort of hide the complexity, which is nice, but in this case is bad. So by using
I think most algorithms books are pretty good about not doing that because that kind of obscures what you're trying to learn.
Yep, totally. But this algorithm is a C++. C++ is a good language for doing this kind of stuff in. And he goes through the code pretty thoroughly. Has a many different categories. I think there's one book where the whole book is just graph theory.
This is five books.
Oh, that's right. So it's actually, it's confusing. It's two books, but one book has parts 1 through 5 in it, or 1 through 4 in it. And the second book has part 5. So a little confusing.
Wow, okay, that's not a little confusing, dude. That's very confusing.
Yeah, it's very confusing. So confusion aside, the book is totally worth it, even then.
So I actually realized we should have done a different book based on our topic today, but we'll save that for another day.
You could.
No, it's okay. It's all right. No, I like mine.
All right.
You're gonna steal it if I don't do it.
Okay. So what's your book of the show?
My book of the show, which I'm not changing because I like it. despite
this book is awesome. Actually, we've both read this book and it's very
good. Yes, so this is good. So Jason did something, algorithms. I mean, that's very technical. That's very like, you know, high level. So something else, which I think sometimes people think is a very complicated topic, but it's really not. It's kind of one of those things where is so algorithms are something where you wouldn't necessarily think to do that on your own. I mean, if you're really smart, maybe you would. And maybe some of the algorithms are kind of like a natural outcropping of something you would already do, and it's just formalizing. But it really is like aha moments. Like, I didn't know. Like, that's how you would find the distance to the closest thing in the graph, or, you know, the shortest path between two points, nodes in a graph. Right? Like, those kind of things are, you could sit down and work out something, but this is, it is really teaching you the formalization of it and also new techniques.
Yeah, like this, often you might have some problem and there's some brute force way to solve anything, right? So pretty much almost any problem, there's some brute force way to solve it that's really easy to code up, but it'll take, you know, forever. Years and years to run. Yeah, and that's when you really need algorithms. But the book you're gonna present, you always need.
Yeah, so this is Head First Design Patterns.
Yep.
So Head First Design, and we'll have a link in the show notes. And so design patterns, we've been asked about a little bit, maybe we'll do it in a show. But I mean, design patterns, a lot of them, like when I first heard it, I was like, whoa, like this sounds crazy. And people talk about it like revolutionizing the way they do coding. And I mean, I don't mean to say those people are wrong or discount them. I mean, it could be, it was in some way for me that, like it was able to teach me to recognize things in my code that I was doing and I wasn't aware of.
Yep.
Change them slightly to make them more kind of generally accepted approach or refine them slightly. But what it is design patterns is really kind of finding common themes and things you need to do in your code.
Yep.
And formalizing them, saying like, hey, here's a really good way to do this. So, you know, kind of the most common one people think about is, at least I think most people think about, is a singleton.
Yep.
So it's the first one you learn about. What is this singleton? And then if you hear about this concept and you don't understand the structure of it, you kind of use it incorrectly. And people are kind of like, oh, this is really clever. Like, I learned this slight coding trick that most languages have to do it, and then I use it as a way to kind of do naughty things that I wasn't supposed to do in other ways.
Yeah.
But Head First Design Pattern will go through. It goes through Singleton. It goes through, you know, Publisher Subscriber, I believe, is in there. There's all sorts of the Decorator Pattern. What are these things? What do they mean? Kind of taking object-oriented a little bit farther and saying, like, hey, let's formalize some of those structures, provide a common way to do them, what they're good for, what they're bad for. And the book is really interesting to read. Like, it's actually of programming books are normally very cut and dry and like, oh, this feels like reading a textbook. This one's not like that. The examples are very fun, kind of like loose ways. Like, oh, I want to have a pizza shop and, you know, I want to be able to create new kinds of pizza in my program, right?
Yep.
These kinds of things, very easy, very real life kind of things, and lots of little pictures and drawings, and kind of it doesn't teach you that very, very in-depth, deep read, but it's a very easy read.
Yeah,
so you can get through it, you can get an idea, and then say, like, do I want to go further from here? What do I want to look up? What do I want to consider?
Yep, and it's got that little bit of that, I don't know what the art style is, but sort of like the you know how you'd see like Rosie the Welder or whatever, right? Like from the 50s.
Like okay.
Yeah, where she's like, there's like just pictures of Rosie, and then she's saying some quote.
That was Rosie the Riveter.
Oh, you're right. Rosie the, what did I say?
The Rosie Welder. The Welder.
So Rosie the Riveter. So it's like a picture of Rosie and she's like, be tough girls or whatever. And so they have this same kind of art style. Like they have this guy who's just like, yeah, coding is totally cool. And he's just like, but it's like a picture, like black and white picture of this guy.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little, I mean, they don't take themselves too seriously.
Yeah, which I think is great. I actually really like the
So, I mean, there's a whole series, this Head First stuff, and a lot of it is really good. I've read some of them, a lot of it haven't.
And the cover has a woman with a gigantic head.
Well, yeah, I guess it is a strange picture. I always thought that was kind of weird. But it's because it's Head First.
Oh! You know, that's one of those things that, like, you once you find out that you didn't get it, you feel really dumb. It's Head First, and it's a woman with a gigantic head, of course.
Okay. Anyways, so yeah, check it out. You know, I like it. I've read it.
Yeah, it's a great book.
Well. I mean, it's not going to probably get you through a design pattern class in school, but it's going to introduce the topic to you, provide a jumping off point. And like I said, it's an easy read, which is rare in computer science
and
books.
It's good to formalize these things. So for example, you know, I played a lot of chess, and then eventually I got to the point where I went to like a chess school where someone taught me a lot of chess. Like,
because I
was
playing.
Yeah, chess I actually won the Florida State Championship.
Nice. I was like 17.
Yeah. So, and so then it's like
there because you didn't have to play me.
Oh, da da da. So there are things that I did, you know, but I didn't really know. You know, I didn't really know them formally. Like, for example, there's something in chess called pinning, where you have like a piece that could like hit the enemy's king, like it could get a checkmate, but there's a piece in the way. Like one of the opponent's pieces is keeping you from checkmating, right? Or from checking the king. Well, that piece is like pinned. Like if he moves the piece, then you would take his king in theory, right? And mm-hmm. win the game. So that piece can't move. And so that there's things you can do. Like you can move to where that piece would have attacked because you know it can't move, for example. And so it's like you might do these things like as just a chess player, but not really like completely understand them and like completely understand the scope and what you're capable of and how they can get out of it. And so when I got like formal training in chess, it like improved dramatically, like over just things I was doing on my own.
And well, so it's a common language too. So now like this pinning concept of which I do not know anything. Would like now if you wanted to Google that, like you could look up strategies related to pinning.
Oh, yeah, that's
now
true.
That you know it, right? So in computer science, to bring this like into like a little bit more, like if you don't know what a singleton is, it's unlikely actually singleton you'd probably figure out on your own. Maybe
but, like publisher subscribe.
But publisher subscribe, like you totally might do that, or the decorator pattern, like you totally might do those on your own.
Yep.
But now that you know what it's called, you can like look up and you can find new ways of doing it or better ways of doing it. Yep. Or like if you have a problem with it, or is it the right case to do it, right? And it provides a language for you to talk to people in.
Yep. And you might be using, let's say, Java, and Java has pub subs for all their event handling for their GUI, for the Java Swing GUI. You know, by knowing the design pattern and knowing that's what, you know, so you could immediately look at that and say, oh, this is what Java's doing. And you know sort of in like what is going on under the covers because like they're probably using the design pattern.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. And then, I mean, design patterns can have many forms of implementations, but, you know, again, they're just their patterns. And there's also anti-patterns, which are also design patterns, but they're ones you probably shouldn't be using.
Yeah, right.
So like, you know, spaghetti code, like we've heard that term. Like, yeah. Okay, that's a design pattern. It's very common, but it's actually a bad one. Like you shouldn't do that.
Right, yep.
So, all right, time for our talk about LaTeX.
LaTeX.
And tech.
And tech. It's not LaTeX or tech.
Yeah, I won't lie, until I was preparing for this show, I always called it LaTeX.
I actually called it LaTeX until my advisor criticized me. He's like, no, it's LaTeX. And so
I kind of feel like I know that's what I guess is the common way or the accepted way, but it's kind of one of those things like it's a word you don't really hear said, you just read it.
And the thing is, especially with not so much with tech, but with or even with tech, like you have Tex-Mex food, right?
Yeah.
Or like you have LaTeX gloves, right?
Right.
So like you're used to using the word a different way or saying the word a different way.
So spelling pronunciation. So it's because tau, epsilon, chi,
right,
which are Greek letters, is what tech is spelled as, and they're kind of, if you ever see it written, it's written and it looks slightly funny.
Yeah.
And that's because it's, you know, trying to be slight, show the typography capabilities of being able to write, for instance, Greek letters.
Yep.
In your stuff. So who wrote the original tech?
Donald Knuth. You know, I think I already said this story once, but it was many episodes ago, but I go to the same optometrist as Donald Knuth.
I think you did.
I still have yet to see him. So I've been to optometrist.
Ah, I see what you did there.
That was totally not intentional.
I've yet to see him.
Yeah, I just keep seeing spots in front of my eyes. No Donald
Knuth. So I actually think it's Knuth as well.
Oh, it's
on
Knuth.
This topic.
Okay.
That's what the pronunciation key says.
Ah, Knuth. Okay. But
if you ever see him at the optometrist,
I don't think he could see me. No, I'm just kidding. But Donald Knuth is rather old. But
74.
74 years
old. Oh, we shouldn't talk about people's age. That's not polite.
Well, he's a public figure.
Okay.
If Wikipedia could do it, we could do it. That should be the new rule on the show. That's a very dangerous rule.
Yep.
So, tech was written by Donald Knuth. Who was a math professor, I believe. I mean, he's known for his computer science contributions. But
right.
I think he originally started off in math.
All right. So I mean, he was upset. He was writing a book, mm-hmm. a kind of famous set of books, Art of Computer Programming. Mm-hmm. And he was disappointed when he was trying to actually do the second revision of his code with the current technology for printing books, typesetting. right? So, you know, way back in the day with Gutenberg, yeah. You know, you would have like little letters which were like carved and you could move them. And yep. That was the movable type printing press. So you could take the block that had the letter carved on it in a specific way and you could move them around to change for each page. And you would bring that whole shelf of letters onto the paper and they would print it, right? Yep. So, but I mean, it was a long time before we kind of got to where that wasn't the way things were done anymore.
Yep.
Because, I mean, you really require computers to be able to do something digitally to kind of shape the letters or put them on a disk or image it or project it. Or, I mean, and that was a relatively modern invention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, so he was dissatisfied with the, you know, so one thing with the computers is like, I mean, you've all seen those like old terminals now that you see them in the cash registers as like DOS terminals with like the DOS box art where it's like they've made art out of the little characters.
Oh, yes, yeah. Yes, yes.
So I mean, computers clearly didn't have the flexibility as these printing presses where you could like, you know, if you wanted to do a subscript, you could just take a smaller number and just put it there because like everything was sort of floating in a sense. So he was dissatisfied with this, and he wrote tech as a way to formally describe, you know, exactly the typography that he wanted with, you know, superscripts and subscripts and all sorts of, you know, formula and things like that. So, and then after tech, somebody started writing macros for tech, as you do with any language, right? As the language grows up, like most of C++ is written in C++. You know, we've talked about this.
Bootstrapping.
Yeah, bootstrapping. So people have written a lot of tech macros to simplify their life, and they'd written so many that it got compiled into something that is now its own program, which is essentially tech with all these macros, and that's called LaTeX.
LaTeX.
La 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 la. And LaTeX is called so because it was made by Leslie Lamport. So he decided to prepend the first two letters of his last name and call it LaTeX.
Guess you get that's your privilege if you if you make such a large contribution.
Yeah, definitely.
So I mean, people may not have ever used this before. So it's like me, like I've heard about this a lot. I haven't very very rarely used it.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, people just think like, oh, this is like Word. So, and it's like, well, kind of. It part of what Word does is related to this.
Yep. Yeah. So, one thing that really separates us from Word is, you know, Microsoft Word and like similar products, they call them WYSIWYG, which means what you see is what you get. And so, you know, with Word, as you're sort of typing and you put an image, you drag the image into your Word doc and it's there, right? Like you see the image. You know, you do different things. Like you create a formula, and there's a little formula, Microsoft Formula Editor. And when you're done, the formula's there, like in the page. And you expect when you print it to just it to look like it does on the screen.
Right.
Tech is not like that. Tech is what you see is what you mean, which is I don't know
exactly.
If that's a cop out or. But so tech is really a programming language, and the idea is, you know, you program your document. And so, for example, the biggest way in which this is noticeable is with figures. So the way tech works is you have what's called a reference to a figure. So you might say, like, you might be talking about a figure in a document. And then in parentheses, you might say, see, you know, and then in the tech, you know, code, you do slash ref, you know, figure one. So, and then it'll actually change it to see figure one, right? But you can actually, in tech, put all of your figures at the bottom of your source file. Like, you could be writing a 300-page book and write all 300 pages of this tech source code, and then at the bottom have, you know, 3 pages of just images.
Mm.
And tech will put your images in the right spot based on your references. So it's a very different paradigm, and in some ways you're kind of at the mercy of the tech compiler, although there are, like, directives you can give it if you really want something a certain way. In some way you're at the mercy of the compiler, but in other ways you... don't have to think about that stuff. You can put all your figures at the bottom and just say, look, put my figures wherever it looks pleasing, you know, or you just write your equations and you say, look, just make this equation work, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So so it is kind of like it's a double-edged sword. But
and yeah, I mean, so like as like a language, like anything, it kind of gets adapted and people are using it for mm-hmm. pervasive and things. So you've used it fairly frequently, right?
Yeah.
So you encountered it in academia or before you got to school?
Academia, yeah.
Okay,
so, all right. So many, almost all academic conferences want you, or even textbooks, things like that, want you to write in LaTeX or Tech.
And which is at least computer science ones.
Yeah, that's true. I can't speak for, although I believe this is, well, I don't know, actually. I can't speak for outside of computer science. I know computer engineering does.
Oh, there you go.
So one of the reasons that a lot of people want you to use LaTeX is because you're writing the source code, it actually takes your source code, your .tech file that you write, and then it also takes as an input a .sty file, a style file. And the style file sort of tells all of those things like what font to use, like when, like should the chapter headings be this point or that point font, should the, you know, should you have a table of contents or not. Like the style file can actually tell LaTeX whether or not to generate a table of contents. You might not have one, right? So it'll do all this crazy stuff. And another thing is the style file sort of is a way that keeps the publisher's stuff, keeps the publisher's like IP in a sense. So for example, we talked about headfirst design patterns, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, they have a certain style, a certain font, you know, they have certain like a way their books look and things like that. And that style's private. Even people who, if you were to write a chapter for headfirst design patterns, you still would not have access to their style. Like it would look totally different to you than when it went into print. And so that way, you know, you couldn't just steal their style and like make your own headfirst Patrick Wheeler patterns thing, you know, book. So it's really common in the professional industry for this reason. Another thing is there's something called BibTeX.
So is that what you wear when you eat lobster? A bib?
No, that's it's a digital bib. It's BibTeX. Yeah. So
a tech bib.
A technology bib. I don't know.
That's one with the LEDs.
Oh man, I totally want an LED bib.
Blue LED.
Like from Tron. That's what Tron would wear if he was eating lobster. He would be wearing a BibTeX. So BibTeX is amazing. You can actually go to scholar.google.com, which is a Google like a scholar, like a research academic paper search. So you can go to scholar.google.com. You could type in Donald Knuth. You'll see a bunch of articles written by him and books and whatnot. And if you wanted to cite one in something you were writing, you could click on import BibTeX and you'll get a .bib file. So, you know,
export.
So oh yeah, well
you're exporting from the article
right.
to a snippet of code.
Yep.
That you're importing into your tech file.
Right. Yeah. So I think the Scholar thing actually says import, and what they mean is
you can import it.
Yeah. Anyways,
okay, I see. That's why you were confused.
Yeah, okay. It's confusing. So you know, you end up with this tech file, this sty file, and all these bib files that you've gotten across the web, and the tech program sort of, you know, munges it all together into this document. So it's pretty freaking cool. It can export to many different formats. This is the part I really like. So I did my resume in tech. And the reason why is because...
Oh, sorry. That's so confusing. It sounds like technology. That's right. Go ahead. Your tech resume.
In LaTeX. Okay. I did my resume in LaTeX. And so the reason why is because I can do LaTeX to HTML. It exports to HTML.
Put it on your website.
Putting it on the website. LaTeX to PDF. It's actually called PDF LaTeX.
Okay. Submitting to a website submission form.
Yeah, exactly. And I also have on the website, it's like for a PDF version.
Oh,
click
download.
Here. Yeah. And so it even does things which I don't really need. There's a DVI format, which is basically an image for every page, like squished mm-hmm. together if you need that. There's PostScript if you're into that. So it has support for many different formats, which is pretty awesome.
So this is pretty flexible, and it kind of is right up our alley as like programmers, right? This is similar to writing HTML and CSS.
Yeah, totally.
So you kind of write your markup for what you want to type, and you don't worry about all this other stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
And then you can kind of worry about formatting as a separate process.
Yeah, that's a perfect analogy. It's just like that. Yeah. So, and then, you know, that way later on, if you decide, oh, I totally want to change the look and feel of my website, but I don't want to have to like redo all the HTML and JavaScript, well, you just change your CSS file. So this is the same kind of thing. Like you can actually have a paper that you submit to one conference or that you put on, you know, your website. And if somebody else likes your paper, you can, you know, give it to them and the HTML content, and then they can, you know, put their own style on it. So,
yeah. Yeah. This is pretty flexible. It's something that, you know, it's good to be aware of because it does, it's useful. It's kind of one of those, like, as a programming topic, it's not like, is it a dynamically typed language?
Yeah, that's right.
Like, I mean, we're not getting into those kind of discussions.
It is Turing complete.
Oh, okay.
I'm sure that's not pretty code to look at.
You know, maybe we'll have to get back into some where we're talking about a lot of those kind of deep topics. Yeah. But this is something that's definitely helpful because people writing resumes, people writing any sort of, you know, text to practice with this and to kind of learn it and understand that it's out there. If you see it on somewhere, you'll know what it means.
Yep. I think the biggest use case is going to be resumes. So, I mean, other than people who have to write, you know, conference papers and things for school, but, you know, if you're going to do your resume, I highly recommend that you use LaTeX. And we'll show you, we'll talk about a little later some tools which will make it easy. But
actually, later is now.
Okay, later is now? All right.
It is. Some tools that make this easy when you're ready to write in LaTeX.
Yeah. So, I use LIX, which is, it sounds dirtier than it is, but...
Wait, it didn't sound dirty.
Oh. LIX?
It didn't sound dirty. Now it does.
Now I gave everyone the mental image. Okay. So LIX, L-Y-X, you dirty people out there. LIX is a WYSIWYG editor that supports LaTeX.
Wait, I thought you said it wasn't
exports
WYSIWYG.
To LaTeX. No, this is WYSIWYG.
Oh.
So this is the cool thing. So LIX looks and feels like Microsoft Word. Mm-hmm. But then it exports to LaTeX, which is pretty awesome. And, you know, of course, they did the thing where you can give it a, you know, an installation of LaTeX, and it'll do the whole thing. Like, it'll go straight to PDF, HTML, all these things. So
LaTeX also kind of wraps up this idea, like, these algorithms for actually doing, like, justification and what should go into the new line and how stuff should be rendered. That kind of rendering. It's not only just the language and the style, but also this rendering to kind of so call it an image, right? Like PDF or this DVL, like as an image, right? Like how many letters should be on each line? What should the font look like? I mean, it handles that as well.
Yeah, totally. And it handles the placement of images, you know, on the page.
Right, right.
It'll know to like move an image to the next page, all that stuff. So it'll actually, it's even more clever than that. It will actually... If you have one line by itself on a page, it'll move it to the next page. So you don't have what's called an orphan line on a page.
Ah.
So it does all these like really clever things that like if you're doing it in Word, you'd have to manually do it, like, you know, hit enter a few times, right? It just does that for you. Just pretty clever. So yeah, you could write your resume in LIX using like the LIX, you know, WYSIWYG editor and get it to look kind of how you want. And then you just, with a couple of clicks, it goes to HTML and it goes to PDF. And, you know, you could do this in Word. Like, Word actually exports to HTML. But the HTML that Word generates is complete garbage. And it's because Word doesn't have this decoupled, you know? Like, when you export LaTeX to HTML, you have your source code, which it creates, like, an HTML file for. And then you have your style that turns into a CSS file. Like, it naturally flows from one to the other. If you've ever exported from Word to HTML, it is just like the most god-awful like thing you've ever seen in your life. Like it's just, you could tell the machine generated, it's just complete garbage. So do your resume in LIX and you will be well rewarded. You will be able to put your resume on your website and it will look awesome.
So I assume it's also able to do the whole like view source and then, you know, like edit your LaTeX file directly. So if you can't figure out what button combination to push to make this thing do this.
Yeah, so it's a little bit trickier than that. What you can do is you can do view source, and I'll show you what it looks like. But if you want to manually put in LaTeX code, you have to do like you have to actually go to insert and say insert like LaTeX code. So you can manually put LaTeX code, it'll actually let you do anything LaTeX will do. And it'll actually, when you're creating functions and things like that, like mathematical functions, it'll let you write LaTeX code there.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, it's pretty freaking cool.
So I have not used this a lot. So I will not have any tools.
Yeah, for tools, I mean, like I said, LIX is a great tool. If you're going to write LaTeX, definitely use LIX. It makes your life a lot easier. We talked a little bit about the uses of LaTeX, you know, mainly academic writing, people writing
books,
textbooks. Yep. Any reference material that you read will probably
I'm intrigued by this bibliography generation thing. This seems like a good idea.
Yeah.
I hate making bibliographies.
Yeah, that's a nightmare, right? So, clearly resume, and we found this out today. You know, someone often says, oh, look at my CV. Well, CV is curriculum vitae, which we knew that much. But if you have two CVs, that is actually curricula vitae.
That's right, not curriculum vitae, yeah, or vitaes, or you're making plural the wrong word.
Yeah, yeah, in Latin you pluralize the first word. Or maybe vitae is an adjective or something. I don't know.
That's like life story, right? So like curriculum is like the noun part, and vitae is the adjective part.
Oh,
we're nerding out now.
I see what you're saying.
So you don't say, I have three reds dog. I have three red dogs. But in just like in many languages, the adjective follows the noun. I don't know Latin.
You know,
that's what Wikipedia said.
I think it makes more sense that the adjective should follow the noun.
It like, does in a way. Because you know what you're talking
about.
Yeah,
you should know that it's the dog.
Bad English.
That's red and fluffy and furry.
You should write a letter.
Yeah, otherwise you get the
letter
wrong
to the
thing
editor.
In your head. Yeah, letter to the English editor.
I don't know who that is, but you write it. Actually, you should email the president of the internet.
Oh.
And then the president of the internet could help you find who the president of English is.
There you go. There you go. Totally. Maybe I'll email the inventor of the internet because that's the person who I know. Al Gore, right?
Didn't Al Gore? You know Al Gore?
No. But
oh.
I know that he invented.
Oh, you just
the
know
internet.
His name. Okay. So you can start there. Okay. I think we're definitely out of time now.
Okay.
So any parting words?
No. Check out our book.
Recommendations?
This is our first book recommendation, so we purposely chose one that we believe strongly is a good book. So
we chose two. I like that you chose one.
We each chose one.
Oh, okay.
That's what I meant. Yeah. So we chose one book that really mattered, and then we chose Head versus Dime Pattern.
Oh! People are going to get the wrong idea, man.
No, both of these books are amazing. Thanks for listening to the show. Thanks for, we complained about using a terabyte of bandwidth last month, but it's amazing. It's great that we have that many people listening
to the
show.
That's right. Keep listening.
Yeah.
And we won't turn this into an advertisement palooza.
Oh, no. It won't be like that at all. Like I said, we generally believe in these books. And the other thing is the next show we're going to do is definitely going to be a real programming topic that I know a lot of people will be interested in. So
okay.
We've done the mailbag. Now we did LaTeX. So you kind of like...
Hardcore.
You
know, we want hardcore programming.
Yeah.
Show off.
Next
time for us to show off our programming chops.
Next time we're going to show some pretty awesome stuff.
All right. Well, till next time.
All right. See you guys later.
The intro music is AXO by Binar Pilot. Programming Throwdown is distributed under a Creative Commons Attribution Share Alike 2.0 license. You're free to share, copy, distribute, transmit the work, to remix, adapt the work, but you must provide attribution... To Patrick and I, and share alike in kind. Hosting provided by Host Tornado. They offer website hosting packages, dedicated servers, and VPS solutions. HostT.net.
Programming Throwdown, episode 22, LaTeX. Take it away, Patrick.
All right, so... Thank you for that introduction, Jason.
Yes, yes.
You got the smooth radio voice going.
Yeah, I want to, keep myself well-rounded. So I figured,
So I'll do some, you do some. That way I don't steal the thunder.
Yeah, yeah. You guys missed the other three takes where Patrick did it. I just started screaming.
No, you were crying because it was so beautiful.
Oh, yeah, that too. Yeah.
All right, anyways. So I'm behind the times, but I finally decided to upgrade my computer to a new version of Ubuntu. So I actually went to the long-term support one or whatever because I figure I don't really like this. I hate this. So I'm just going to the LDS one. So I went to Precise Pangolin.
Yep. Precise Pangolin.
Bad idea.
Yeah.
So, do not like. So, I wish I could just uninstall.
So on my home computer, I've been on Precise Pangolin I was on Precise Pangolin. I'm on 12.10 now. And that, there's a whole slew of issues there. But... when I switched to Unity, I didn't mind it too much,
So I think this is the issue, right? So Unity, this is the new, UI kind of name thing and widgets.
Yeah, so it's replacing GNOME.
Okay, yeah. All right.
So GNOME is what we had before, and now we have Unity.
I wish we didn't. Yeah. So the whole left bar thing, I don't like.
Be united?
No, I feel like they're just trying to be different just to do something different, right? Maybe I'm sure, I don't get into the whole, I'm not really involved in the community very much. I don't really know the backstory, so I'm probably offending a million people here.
Yeah, everyone's so
that's okay. I don't like it, personally. My personal preference is I hate it. So I want my thing at the bottom back or at the top where I can click on each instance of, like, if I have, you know, five Chrome windows open or five, you know, command windows open, like whatever it is. Like I want to be able to, like, switch between them on the task when I don't, it doesn't work for me mm-hmm. to not be able to, like, I feel like it's constantly in my way instead of helping me.
Yeah. So I've had it for a while. At first I hated it. Now I've started to like it. There are some things that still drive me crazy. And one of them is, you know, they have the dash, like they moved to this dashboard. So you actually have to click on, like, dash home and then type in, like, so if I want, you know, if I want Chrome, I click on dash home and then I have to type in Chrome and then it comes up. Whereas before, they had that bar at the top that had, like, applications, just, yeah. utilities, and it's, like, effectively, like, this multi-start menu thing going
on. But you can push Alt and get that too, right?
You can do what?
I think if you just tap Alt, it comes up.
Really?
I think on my computer it does. Maybe that's a setting. I don't know.
Maybe.
I feel like I did that on mine because every time I Alt tab and then I don't get the tab fast enough, that thing comes up.
Oh.
So maybe my setting is different. I don't know.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, weird.
Maybe that's something too. Maybe I just, like, haven't tweaked in the settings right. Like, so I upgraded also a while ago to the new version of OS X. I don't even know what the names
oh,
are.
Oh, yeah.
Really bad.
It was like Mountain Lion for a while. I don't know if it still is.
Yes, that's it.
Is that it? Mountain okay. Lion.
And they switched Leopard. The switch. So I was skipped two. Like, I skipped one. So I skipped
Snow
the intermediate.
Leopard.
Okay.
Maybe.
I'm really bad with the names. This is horrible.
I
should have researched this. It doesn't matter.
From Snow Leopard.
I went from scrolling normally on the trackpad to scrolling the reverse way.
Yeah.
I tried it. Like, I'm like, I'm going to like this. This must be great. And then one day later, I turned it off.
Yeah, me too.
I'm like, nope.
Actually,
like
you lasted a lot longer than I did. I only lasted about an hour. I was like, I can't take it. And so it's like, it's funny. I still think about it. So let me just give everyone sort of a mental model for what's happening here. So it used to be that if you put two fingers on the pad and you moved your fingers down, you scroll down. If you move them up, you scroll up. And it logically makes sense. But if you think about it in terms of, like, putting your hand physically on a piece of paper.
No, if the touchpad were the screen.
Right, exactly.
And it was a piece of paper, yeah, and you touched it and slid it up, the screen would move down. Like,
yeah.
The paper would, like, where you're viewing would move lower on the page.
Exactly. Like, if you focus your eye on a spot, and then you took your fingers, you put them down on a piece of paper, and you moved up, that spot, what you're looking at on the page would be lower. So you would actually be scrolling down by moving your fingers up.
It's basically like the tablet. That's what happens on the tablet.
Yeah.
You touch on the screen, and then the words underneath your finger stay underneath your finger.
Exactly, yeah.
Which is why it makes sense.
Yeah.
But on my trackpad, because I've been doing it for, I'm an old person, I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
Like, oh, people are like, they're making fun of us because they're like, oh, those, like, people aren't, they are not old, what are they talking about?
Are these crotchety old?
No, they're saying the opposite. They're like, those guys aren't old. Anyways, so, like, scroll, anyways, yeah, I don't like that. So that's my rant, but the Ubuntu thing I really didn't like. And I mean, there's all sorts of ways to get out from under it. The problem is, like, when you deviate from this, like, you're stuck in this thing. So there's always been, like, when before I was a big Windows user, and I still do use Windows for a lot of stuff, you know, there's, like, all these shell hack things you can do to, like, make your computer look different. And that's cool. But then if you go to upgrade the next one, like, it doesn't work and you're used to something different.
Yep.
So I feel like I want to stay as close to vanilla default installation as possible because then I don't always have to, like, reinstall stuff and change stuff.
Yep. I used to do this. I used to, even when I ran Windows, I used to have, like, all of these things. Like, I had one which, like, split my desktop into four if I wanted it to. I had another one where, like, the terminal, like, you could... it was easier to paste. Like, if you just right-clicked, it pasted instead of having to, like, do something else. I don't know. But, like, I made all these tweaks to it, and then I updated to, I think it went from XP to 7, and I lost everything, and I just said, forget it. I'm not going to waste time.
And then the same tools
don't
work anymore, and you can't do that. Or if you go use somebody else's computer, it doesn't work the same.
Yeah, yeah. I have a friend who's addicted. Well, he's, like, a real zealot for Dvorak keyboards. And, like, he came over to my house and couldn't even, like, type an email. It was hilarious.
Aww. So, I mean, same thing. Like, I've always thought, like, oh, I should do this, right? Like, it makes the way the QWERTY keyboard is set up is retarded.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's literally meant to make you type slower.
Yep.
And that's why they invented it. And we've probably all heard the story, right? So, like, I want to switch. But the problem is, like, I know if I switch, not every computer, like, I don't have complete control over every computer that I use, or I go use somebody else's computer, or somebody, you know, like, especially, like, at work, somebody, like, it's rare, but somebody sometimes needs to use, like, show me something on the computer or type something in, they can't use it.
Yep.
Like,
yep.
You know, if I reboot or something updates, like, auto updates and, like, somehow removes it and I boot up and, like, my password won't work, like, it's going to take me forever to figure it out, like,
yep.
Then you're typing things that don't match a keyboard. Yeah, I just, I don't know. It should be good, and I should do it, I guess. I just,
but
for compatibility's
sake.
Right?
Yeah. It's just not worth it.
And that's the same thing with a lot of tech, not just software, but even other stuff. I remember like having early versions of iPads, right? Like essentially these other tablet devices or, you know, Palm Pilot style things. And it's never worked. They didn't have wide adoption. Yep. You were kind of out on the fringes, and they just didn't have the same support. Once something goes mainstream, we don't like it because now it's not elitist and cool at some level, but at another level, it's just so much nicer because now, yep, I can go to Target and or Walmart or wherever, Amazon, and I find like 100 different choices for what phone case I want if I have, you know, a current popular phone or an iPad or, you know, whatever, yeah, you know, like there's, because stuff is more mainstream.
Yeah, I mean, I have an Android phone and I still suffer from this a little bit, like, and now not so much anymore because Android phones are getting more popular, but especially like a year ago, it's like I want this cool case, but it's only for iPhone.
Well, so I have an iPhone, this is what my main phone is, and like, mm-hmm, it works really. So I had an Android phone, and the nice thing is that they've gone less split. So it used to be like everybody had a slightly different version of the same Android phone.
Yeah, right.
You know,
right.
And it was very fragmented. Now they're going like less. So like one phone will be released across all the carriers.
Yep.
And so that's nicer because then you can make a case. But if you have like, oh, one has a keyboard and one doesn't, and one has a little antenna and one doesn't, like then, yeah, that never happens.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, it's a nightmare.
Anyways, yeah, don't like the Unity thing. I'm sorry, not a fan.
We'll see. I want to know your opinion in like 3 or 4 months.
So I've been at it for like 2 or 3 weeks now. So. Yeah. And I gave it a fair shake. I'm really tempted to turn it off, like figure out the best way to turn it off.
But you know what? Especially with Linux or any of these OSs, you know what's going to happen. The next version, like whatever your hack you're doing to get around it now will be gone.
Yes.
Like it won't even be there. So. So
right, that's my rant.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
so now to something slightly happier. I'll take the first news story.
Now something slightly happier. A lot of people are killing each other virtually.
So Call of Duty Black Ops 2. So I'm not a huge like current gamer. I like video games, but mm-hmm, I play a lot of old video games.
Same here.
Cheap. Sorry, I wait for them to like crash in price and then be like really cheap Steam sale.
Oh, you're not thinking, I'm thinking really old. Like
Or I love playing my Super Nintendo games or my NES games or like, I like old stuff. I don't know, it's just simpler and I don't have a lot of time to play video games, or I don't make a lot of time to play video games, I should say. But it has 150 million hours have been played. That's crazy.
Absolutely insane. And $1 billion.
In 15 days, faster than Avatar hit $1 billion.
Amazing.
So like the new media consumption is so interesting. And it's so expensive. Like personally, I feel
like $60 or something.
I don't know how much. That's why I would say probably $70, right?
Wow.
Like it can be really expensive, and I don't know. I mean, we should look at it. It's probably $50 or $60. But still, like that's just crazy to me.
That's
like
a ton.
That's a lot of. And I'm not saying like if you're gonna play it for a lot of hours, like well worth.
Oh no, it's totally worth.
Like
it.
The dollar per hour thing.
Yeah.
But I'm just like, hitting $1 billion is crazy. Like people have talked about this a lot, like, oh, are video games eating into the movie market or vice versa, and video games are becoming more like movies and like back and forth and all this stuff. And I feel like they're two very different styles of entertainment for me personally.
Yep.
I don't replace one with the other. I feel like they're just different. But yeah, I mean, it's a serious business being in this now.
The thing that blows me away, so movies, right? So you could watch, you know, some people watch, let's say Rocky Horror Picture Show, right? That's like a cult classic. Some people watch that show like every month, like they'll go and watch Rocky Horror and it's like a big event and people have fun, right? So it's not true that you only watch a movie once. That part isn't true, but if you look at like overall, most people only watch a movie once, like a particular movie. With a video game, the hours that you put into it vary wildly. Like some people might play Call of Duty or any game for like a couple hours and they're done. And some people play it for like months and months and months, right? And so this whole like dynamic of sort of like just having this extremely variable mileage that you get out of this entertainment, I think it's just fascinating. And then you have this other thing too where some games are like, you know, have this massive budget. Like Call of Duty, I'm sure their budget was in the tens of millions.
Right, yeah.
Right? But then some games are just like Super Meat Boy. Have you played this game?
No.
It's a platformer where you have to like run and jump and like there's little like things trying to grind. Like you're a blob of meat and you're in this like meat processing facility and you have to go through all the blades without getting cut or whatever. And it's like one guy made it or two guys made it in their spare time or I guess maybe it was their full-time job, but these two guys made it and it provided me like hundreds of hours of entertainment, like trying to like navigate these mazes and all this stuff. And just the fact that like this ratio of like investment to investment to return, and then return to entertainment. Like these dynamics are just incredible, and it's something that like is very hard to explore right now, or very hard to know, quantify.
Yeah, and the enjoyment like over time changes, right? So like if you go play, especially like this Black Ops 2, like day one, people probably got online, started playing right away, and got good.
Yeah.
And then like you jump on like a couple weeks later, whatever, like, no, let's see. And then you're like, no, like, it's bad. And even with matchmaking and all that stuff, like, yeah, okay. I mean, you can alleviate some of that, but still, like, I mean, you don't always have the best. You have to stick with it before it becomes really enjoyable, right? Like, mm-hmm. before you're at least doing well enough where it's kind of fun. I mean, maybe it's fun before that, too, for some people. I guess, well, it depends.
You know, with the Xbox, they actually have modes. They have a hardcore gamer mode. Then they have another mode, which I can remember. But then the third one, which is what I picked, was family mode. And it doesn't mean you don't see blood or anything like that. It just means, like,
you can get through the whole game without dying.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's like basically, it's like, well, it's for multiplayer. But it's like, okay. You have a family. You're not going to be able to beat this kid who, like, practices all day. So, like, you play in this league on your own with the rest of the people who can't play well.
Yeah. It's like at the airport, they have this. They have, like, different lanes. Like, the business lane, the normal lane, the family lane. I always see people going in the wrong lane. It's like, what is the purpose of this? Is it, like, the family with, like, 30 bags, like, going in the one that shows, like, business traveler, travels all the time, has one carry-on or whatever. Yeah. You know, anyways, okay. So the price is retail $60 for the console and the computer, but it looks like you can get it for cheaper.
So this is the thing
online.
That blows my mind, right? Is I bought, and this is gonna make me sound really pathetic, but I bought Super Mario 3 right when it came out. Actually, to be fair, my mom bought Super Mario 3 for me right when it came out, and it was I think $70.
Wow!
And now it has been over 20 years. And video games are still selling for $70.
Like, oh, I never thought about it that way.
Yeah, like the price of a video game hasn't changed in 2 decades. And like just the amount of content and the budget has gone up dramatically. Like I'm sure the budget for SMB3, Super Mario Bros. 3, was not what the budget of Call of Duty is, you know, even with inflation, right? So it's just, that part is wild. Like, the margins have come way down, right, on video games.
Yeah, I mean, but they're selling a lot more. Like, I mean...
Yeah, that's true, too.
Pretty sure 150 million hours weren't played in the first 2 weeks of Super Mario Brothers 3.
Yeah, totally. Totally.
Yeah, I don't see the initial price. You're probably right. I mean, I remember seeing something about consoles being really expensive. Like, we complain about them being expensive now, but, like, that they used to be crazy expensive, especially if you take into account inflation. So, yeah. All right. Our next news story. You found something that you want for Christmas.
I also found on answers.yahoo, how much did Super Mario Bros. 3 cost when it first came out? This guy said $50. Oh, no, but somebody else said $70, yeah.
Okay, so around 50. Yeah, so about the same price.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. Okay.
All right. Anyway.
Ruined that transition.
Yeah. So... Yeah, so I totally, you know, actually my mom today was like, I don't know what to get you for Christmas. You know, she always says this every
year. Well, now you know she's going to spend $70 adjusted for inflation.
Yeah, exactly. So I want a Super Mario 3 cartridge. So I actually think this thing is totally cool. I only found out about it minutes before recording the show, but I immediately
want one. Lots of research.
Yeah, after lots of research. They have an Android stick PC. And the idea is, it has an HDMI port, so you can plug it into your television. This one
and
that
it looks
I
like
linked
a thumb
to,
drive.
Yeah, that's right. It's very small. This one I linked to apparently needs like certain type of TV that can provide power through the HDMI cable.
Yeah, that one. I mean, it looks like it has a port there for like a USB or power USB. Everything. Yeah, so you can either, if your TV supports getting power from HDMI, that'll work. Which the newer TVs do, but there's a way to power it alternatively as well.
Oh, perfect. Yeah, so you can... So imagine, like, you have, like, the kind of Android power that you would in a phone or something, but it can connect to your TV without having, like, a mini HDMI. Like, it just has complete HDMI. And you can have it, like, hook up to your TV 24/7. And you do all sorts of cool stuff with it. So I think it's a really fun toy. I think that there's a lot of cool stuff I'd want to do with it.
Yeah, it's kind of like the Raspberry Pi style thing, right?
Yeah. You can plug in, or you can use a wireless keyboard and mouse. So I'm assuming it has some kind of Bluetooth receiver or transmitter. So yeah, it seems pretty fun. I haven't really, you know, I just found out about it, so I haven't thought about what cool stuff. Immediately, the thought that comes to mind is to get MAME running on it and then have like
to play arcade games.
Yeah, have like the smallest arcade cabinet ever. Actually, I want to get into like woodworking, like not serious, like where it looks good, but just like a saw and a piece of wood and have like be able to make stuff because I'm really inept.
We'll have to talk about this another time. I actually started doing woodworking, but
did
like
you really?
The kind where it looks good.
Oh, wow. We'll do that next show. That'll be our intro.
Right.
We'll have to remember. Okay. Anyway, so I want to make...
Well, I should... The kind of look like attempting to try to make it look good, sorry.
The goal is good.
Okay,
mine,
yes,
the
yes.
goal is just mediocre, yeah.
Okay.
Just functional. See, I want to make an arcade cabinet with one of these little sticks and, like, I don't know, like a really tiny, or maybe like an arcade.
I think somebody did
that.
I saw that
on
one
something.
Of the like hacker, like
oh,
computer
really?
Hacker things. Yeah, like
oh, nice.
Super miniature arcade cabinet or something. It was like really small.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, yeah. Who knows what I'm gonna do?
Maybe it'll be
thing.
A kit, and then you don't have to do any woodworking. Your
oh,
woodworking,
perfect.
Your woodworking can just be to glue it up, and then you don't even have to worry about. So this one looks like it houses your phone.
Oh, that's awesome.
But you could do, like, I mean, you could hack it to just be something else. Okay, anyways,
yeah,
we're looking
totally.
At pictures and you guys cannot see them.
Awesome.
So, best podcast ever.
Speaking of woodworking.
So, yeah, so on my notion of crazy things to do with woodworking, because one of my goals with woodworking is to build automata. So,
really?
Automata are those, well, it means a variety of things, but the ones I'm thinking of are wooden contraptions where you have like a little hand crank on the side and you crank it and there's like a scene that takes place, like almost like a diorama, if you know what that is,
yep.
on top of the little box. So you like crank it and there's like, you know, like a horse that pretends like it's running or like a caterpillar pretends like it's crawling.
That's amazing.
Or some guy that's like pretending like he's eating a sandwich and waving or a dog that jumps through a hoop. Like
I saw something that's totally epic. That's along the lines of what you're talking about. This guy made a bicycle. And as part of pedaling the bicycle, a set of mechanical actuators and stuff went, and it's totally analog, so it's not computer or anything. A pen drew his signature, or like something that was pretty close to his signature.
Yeah. So this would have like gears and
yep.
pulleys and screws and yeah, all these crazy things to make the things on top do something. And then you leave the bottom where all those things are exposed so that people can kind of see it working. That's part of the nostalgia of it or
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah, right.
That's what I kind of want to do.
That's
so,
amazing.
But it's a very lofty goal. I don't know when I'll make. So the other thing I want to do is make a wooden clock. So you can make
really?
like all the gears and the pendulum and the escapement, the
everything
thing that makes
wooden?
It tick, and it's all out of wood.
Right. Wow.
So I have crazy, grandiose ideas. We can
oh, that's amazing.
Sometime.
So do you have a woodworking, like, I mean, do you have some kind of benches?
I'm acquiring it.
Oh,
so like
okay.
I'm like in the process of like starting, like doing some small projects, learning the skills, that kind of stuff.
That's
working
awesome.
My way up.
That's great.
So I saw this, and it immediately intrigued me, because when I was growing up, I would always be the kid in the class who, like, when somebody asked them, they'd be like, why? But, like, not
yeah.
just to be, like, a jerk, but, like, really wanted to know, like,
yeah.
like, why is it that way? And so, like, one of the things was computers. Like, oh, it counts in binary. And it's, like, for the longest time, I thought, like, oh, binary couldn't represent every number. Because, like, somebody just told it to me, like, that's crazy. Like, ones and zeros only? Like, seriously?
Yeah.
And nobody bothered, like, nobody, my teachers at the time didn't know how to really explain that to me, that, like, no, this is, it's a number system. Here's why it can represent
yeah,
every
it's
number.
Base two.
None of that, right? It's, like, completely more obscure. And one of the things, once I figured that, I was, like, on this quest, like, I want to understand how a computer processes things. Because people know this, right? Like, oh, people who know a little bit about computers would say, like, oh, it has an instruction set. You'd be like, what? Like, what's an instruction set? What does it do? How does it, like, how does it know the number, know the other number, put the numbers together, you know, and make something, right? Like, how does that work? And so this kit called the Digicomp 2 is something that was made in the 50s. And what it is I'm just going to try to describe it. It's like a wooden flat piece.